Welcome. We invite you to join us on a spiritual journey. You know, no one person or even author has the answer to all the questions. Only God Almighty. But here's one thing I do know. You are loved. There's nothing you can do to make God love you more. And there's nothing you can do to make God love you less. You are loved. Simply that. So I invite you to join us on a journey of drawing near to the heart of God, where that love can transform us. I invite you to connect with us and share your comments on the comment section below this YouTube video, or visit us on our Facebook page and share in the inspirations during the week and again share your insights, or visit our website mccgd.org. Share with us your prayer requests or your praises, and know that we will pray with you and celebrate with you because we are on this journey together. Now I pray that God will bless you, that you will have an awesome week in your words, your work, your actions, and your life. God bless.
When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
Ils virent apparaître comme une sorte de feu qui se partageait en langues et qui se posa sur chacun d'eux.
Ils furent tous llenos de l'Espíritu Santo y comenzaron a hablar en otras lenguas, según el Espíritu les daba que hablasen.
Τώρα όλος το κόσμος μένει στο Ιερουσαλήμ. Ο Χριστός φοβάται Ιβραίους, αλλά όλος το κόσμος ουρανός.
Когда сделался этот шум, и собрался народ, и пришел в смятение, ибо каждый слышал их, говорящих его наречием.
都惊讶稀奇说，看哪，这说话的不都是加利利人吗？
Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues.
Sie entsetzten sich aber alle und wurden irre, und sprachen einer zu dem anderen, was will das werden? Die anderen aber hatten ihren Spott und sprechen, sie sind voll süßes Weins.
When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rush of violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? In our own languages, we hear them speaking of God's deeds of power.
I believe that the Spirit moves between us, just like the wind moves between us and the air moves between us. How about you? Yes. So as we come to a time of prayer, I invite us to remember our connections to all those who have served in the military. On this Memorial Day weekend, we remember all those who've given their life in the service of their country. So I invite us to remember all those who gave their life in military service. And I know that you have prayer concerns as well. So I'm going to invite you to take a moment of reflection to give thanks for those who've given their lives. We remember those two who are serving. But Memorial Day is particularly remembering those who've given their lives in service. We remember them. And then as we spend that time in prayer for them, then to also think about the things that you bring to God in prayer. I'm going to play some music, and it'll be instrumental at first as we remember.
And then it will go into a prayer, and I invite you to listen and watch the lyrics and take all the prayers of your heart with this song in prayer and let it just carry all the prayers that we have for ourselves, for those we love, for our world. Let's pray together.
Of the Trinity, through belief in the threeness through confession of the oneness of the Creator of creation.
Amen. The people that were in the crowd that day heard them, the disciples, speaking in his or her native tongue about God's deeds of power. We have just shared in our prayerful reflections and our prayers of intercession. Now we need to talk about God's deeds of power. How have you experienced God's deeds of power recently? What compelling word do you have to share, or do you need to share or need to hear today about God's compelling and powerful deeds of power? So I'm going to invite you just to turn to somebody near you, pairs, threes, and share how God has blessed you recently.
Amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "People of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men should dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved."
"When the Advocate comes, whom will I send to you from Heavenly Parent? The Spirit of Truth, who comes from God, will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning." And from Margaret Mead, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has."
Today we are a small group of thoughtful and committed citizens. We are spiritual citizens of the realm of God. Amen? Amen? And it was a small group of spiritually committed, thoughtful citizens of God's realm and in the area of Jerusalem who were filled with the Spirit of God. And I pray that you each are filled with the Spirit of God, that we can do life-changing work as the disciples did. So as we begin today, though, we're going to take a look at some of our own spiritual diversity. So I want you just to call out quickly and just say, here, if I call out the denominational background, the religious background that you were raised in, it doesn't mean I visited that church once. Okay, but something that was formative for you. So if you were raised in MCC, I was thinking I was going to hear from you, Mary. You've been many years in MCC. Half. How old were you when you came to MCC? Six or eight?
Sixth grade.
Yeah. I'd say that's pretty formative, don't you? Give her a hand. Been in MCC a long time. Okay, if you were raised Catholic.
Here.
Lutheran.
Here.
Episcopalian. Methodist.
Here.
Presbyterian.
Here.
United Church of Christ. You have to shout. I'm not hearing the sounds.
Here.
I'm not seeing it. Okay, good. All right. Disciples of Christ. I know we have some in our members. Church of Christ. African Methodist Episcopal, AME, CME, Southern Baptist,
Here.
Baptist, all the other varieties, Independent Baptist, American Baptist, Primitive Baptist, have any of those? Okay, there you go. Seventh-day Adventist, we have several in our congregation. Latter-day Saints, Mormon, Jehovah's Witness,
Here.
Salvation Army, Here. Nazarene,
Here.
Assembly of God, Holiness Church, Pentecostal, independent with no affiliation, no religious background. You were raised with no religious background. Let's talk about other faiths. You were raised Buddhist. We have some of those. Hindu, Muslim. Okay, are there others that I missed of your religious background? Call it out. We are a diverse group. I'm going to tell you, the list that I made in mind with people who attend here. There's someone that attends this church from every one of those backgrounds. Is that not amazing? That's quite the picture. And so that reflects on our Pentecostal story. How is it we hear, each of us in our own language, Catholic, Methodist, Baptist, Pentecostal, non-Christian, how is it we hear about the powerful deeds of God in a way we can understand? Well, that's because God gives us the ability to speak it in a way that someone else can hear it. Not everybody hears the same way, amen? Amen. We don't all learn the same way either, but God gives us that variety. So today I'm going to have some variety in the preaching. I got some preaching help. I'm going to ask you in a moment if you would give a hand and help welcome some folks to the stage. This is a small group of thoughtful, committed people who are helping to change our world. So would you welcome Tyler James, Kathy Elder, Carla Lane, and Reverend Stephen Pace. And come on up here, you all. Encourage them now. And I got a microphone for you. Test, test. Say test, test. Hello.
Test, test. Hello.
Do they have to turn anything on? Okay, you got it. And then you're unwired and you're wired, so there we go. All right. So each of you, just quickly, so they know for the background that you're coming from, what's your religious background?
Southern Baptist.
Non-denominational charismatic.
Yeah, I didn't say charismatic. I said Pentecostal, but not charismatic. Woo.
Church of the Nazarene.
And
Pentecostal.
Okay. I don't think Stephen's mic's on. I'm not sure.
No,
okay. There you go. All right. I'm asking them to help us. So I'm going to ask each of them to speak briefly about what images or metaphors help you describe your experience of the Holy Spirit. In other words, my personal experience of the Spirit is like. So let me start with Carla. How would you describe that?
Like a peaceful wind or a calming river. That's what I would say it is when everything goes right and flows right.
That is brief, okay, and that's clear. That's good. That's good.
Clear it is.
Clear. Okay, like a flowing river, and everything flows.
Everything feel flows. Falls in place.
Okay, Stephen, how about you?
I think we're still working on my mic.
Okay, then just grab that one then. I'll go to Kathy. Then will you do something with your mic?
I think of those summertime rainstorms where the sun is still shining, and things are washed away, but the light is still there to illuminate. Everything.
So the sun illuminating.
But the water cleanses.
But the water cleansing. Kind of a both and. Just letting some of those images sink in for you as well. Tyler, how about yourself?
Are you wanting like a one sentence answer?
No, it doesn't have to be one sentence. Okay. I allowed more time. They were really brief.
So how we experience the Holy Spirit?
Yeah, just right. Help. What images or metaphors help you describe your experience of the Spirit?
I mean, if you want a metaphor, mine would probably be like fire or light.
Fire or light?
Mm-hmm.
And how do you experience that as fire?
Sometimes it's like a literal physical warmth that's associated, or like a tingling. I feel on my arms and on my stomach and on my chest, like it's actually physical. But regardless, it's what that fire and light, right? It's like warmth and comforting and very present and near, as opposed to cold and distant and calloused and insensitive.
I'm hearing all three are very interactive, though. This flowing, the sense of the flow and like the water flowing in it. And then the action with the cleansing water, and yet the sun rays coming through it, that there's an interaction that you're experiencing. And then you're experiencing it, saying that you experience it in a very personal way. I suspect that's true for each of you as well. And Stephen, have we got?
I think for me it's more of a sense of presence. It's like when you're in a room and somebody else is in the room too, but they're not in your sight line, but you know they're there. And somehow the fact that they're there is comforting. It's reassuring some way, and you don't even have to see them, but you know they're there, and so that there's a presence, and it feels physical, like I could reach over and touch you, but that might not be the case, but I know that I could, and there, so it's very personal.
These are great images that can help us grasp it, because it's hard to nail down exactly what the Spirit is like. And that's what, earlier I had the children trying to draw the wind or draw the breath. It's hard to draw the wind. You can draw the effects of the wind. So when we use metaphors, it's like the Spirit is like this, and I think that the Spirit is like every one of these ways, and however you experience the Spirit is your experience, and it may connect with one of these people, but you may not connect with somebody else's description, which is just fine, right? But very personal, and you're aware, and you experience, but maybe harder to pin down, if you will. We've often here described and quoted the Native American saying that says, "I don't know if it happened this way, but I know it's true." And in the MCC lectionary discussion group this past week, Reverend Dr. Darraugh Watkins said, "The point of Pentecost isn't indoor wind, floating flames, or miraculous linguistics. These are clearly metaphors, not literal occurrences. Remember, John's gospel images the apostles being filled with the Spirit by having the resurrected Christ breathe on them. Luke uses more theatrics, but the point is the passion and commitment of early church leaders, not the imaginative way that Luke tells the story of their energy, wind, passion, fire, and willingness to speak in ways that help people embrace hope in their own context, tongues." He went on to say, "Remember, explanation is not experience." We're trying to explain our experience. "We have powerful experiences of the Spirit that demand we use big language in order to communicate the impact of the experience. But the metaphors, idioms, and euphemisms we choose to tell people about our profound spiritual insights and breakthroughs might distract from what really occurred if people took them too literally." So being in a pickle has nothing to do with cucumbers and vinegar. Right? So we're not talking about literal fire, literal rivers, literal rain, literal ghosts. Some people talk about the Holy Ghost and are fearful by that language. That's not what we're talking about. Raining cats and dogs has nothing to do with animals, but we use that kind of language to experience a powerful or describe a powerful rain, right? Or being between a rock and a hard place has nothing to do with geography or geology. Hot and cool doesn't always refer to temperature. Frozen doesn't always mean ice, and batty may have nothing to do with actual bats. And yet, we have these experiences of the Holy Spirit that are like a presence, rain, sun, fire, and rushing waters moving. How have you experienced the Spirit giving you a second wind or a new beginning? It says that the disciples were truly animated or empowered by their experience of the Spirit. So how have you experienced the second wind or new beginning, maybe a rebirth or a renewed passion? Maybe it's about the Holy Spirit animating your work. So how have you experienced the Holy Spirit at work? Before we were describing an image, but now how would you experience the Spirit at work? Stephen, let's begin with you.
Probably one of the most striking ways for me is that there are times where I need energy and I don't know where it's going to come from, but all of a sudden I'm able to tap some internal resource that pulls that energy back up, because some of the work that I do is just emotionally and physically draining. And when you're at a certain point of exhaustion, then it's hard to think creatively or act creatively, and all of a sudden that energy is there, and I believe that it comes from my faith. I think that is partly when I think about Christ in me or God's presence alive in me. I think that's what I'm able to tap into, and suddenly there is energy and life and hope and new ability to continue on with what it is I'm needing to do.
And Carla, how about you?
I think mine would be in a difficult situation. I came from West Texas, and our facility closed. And if you're from a town, you don't ever fathom ever leaving. And so when we were all told that we would have to find employment hundreds of miles away, I didn't know where to go. I felt like I was between a rock and a hard place. And I prayed and I prayed and I couldn't figure out, and I was trying to do it myself. I was looking for jobs. I was worried about housing. I was worried about finances. And finally, it came to the point where I couldn't do anything else. And at that point, I had to give it over. And once I relinquished power and gave it over, then the peace, everything fell in place. A job came available in Gainesville, wasn't far from home, 3 hours, but still not as far as it could have been. There was somebody to keep the kids until they got out of school because I couldn't take them out at the time. The facility gave me housing. I didn't have to look for housing. So I know that I couldn't have done that. That couldn't have been done by me because I had tried everything. And so I know that was the Holy Spirit. I know the Holy Spirit took over and said, rest. I will take care of it. And the peace that I felt, it was just like a big rock was taken off my shoulder. And that's all I had to do was just go, just do it, just live. And so that was my biggest experience with the Holy Spirit.
Both of you talked about energy there in a way, you know, but the Spirit, really that fresh wind of the Spirit that blows some new energy right into us. Wow. And Tyler?
There are two different experiences that come to my mind when I hear you ask that question. The first is one of the most significant ones that I've had in life so far, and I was with a group of people in India, in a children's home, and a lot of the people who were there were actually little kids, and their faith was just stunning. And there was a time of prayer, and I came out on the other side of that time of prayer with this sense, very clearly, kind of overwhelmed, but nevertheless clear, that the Holy Spirit was a real person who could affect life as tangibly and even more tangibly than a human could. And that the Holy Spirit had a voice and the Holy Spirit had hands on the inside of human beings. And that emotional turmoil or that mental snare or that physical deficiency or pain, that the Holy Spirit actually lived inside of people to bring about healing and transformation in really measurable, concrete ways. And I saw it and I experienced it and I felt it. And ever since then, there's been a much more vivid interaction with the Holy Spirit, where if I'm talking to someone and I'm noticing that they're trapped in something or they're expressing pain about something, one of my first inclinations now is not to try and talk them out of it, but to get the Holy Spirit involved in the situation. And it's worked 100 times. And it's just that real. And then the other thing that comes to my mind is a little bit odder, but it was after my junior year of college, and I was interning somewhere, a ministry, and it was the first time in my life that I really sat still for a long time, long periods of time, and I would just sit for at least an hour or two a day. And I did that for a few months. And by the end of it, I felt my own soul tenderize so much more. And I felt like I could experience the presence of God and be with God in a way that I never could before. And ever since then, there's been a much more constant sense of presence and comfort. And it's like there's a best friend that's constantly actually present all the time. And that's very, very rejuvenating to me in a daily way.
So an attentiveness to the presence of the Spirit and a nurturing of that relationship, mm-hmm. Soaking in the presence of God, spending time, mm-hmm. giving it that time. I love in the book, The Shack, the description of the Holy Spirit, because it's kind of, there's a person, a distinct person, but very hard to pin down, kind of much more of a spirit that seems to be moving. If you've read it at all, it's a great book to look at the persons of the Trinity in a great way. But that image of the Holy Spirit working in the garden of the soul, mm-hmm. and that the Spirit is weeding and tending and staking up plants and just working on that garden of the soul is another one of those personal kinds of experiences I find.
I resonate with that a lot.
And feel like that the Holy Spirit's often working in me and at me as well as through me. How about you, Kathy? How's the Spirit been working in your life or at work in you?
I would say the biggest way is through healing. As, you know, pretty much any human, I've experienced pain, I've experienced loss, I've experienced, you know, things that aren't enjoyable, but including through the church. And the Holy Spirit has made itself known to me by saying, that's not what I'm about. That's not what God is about. I am about love and peace and kindness and all the fruits of the Spirit and all the messages of Jesus, not what other people say in my name. And accepting that has led me on a journey of healing that I couldn't be on without the Holy Spirit, because there's some things that no matter how great a therapist is, they're even capable of doing, because Amen. The Holy Spirit is stronger.
That connects those two. So the Spirit has led you on a journey, and you just got another piece of that journey revealed to you.
Yes.
Last night, a piece of mail coming to you that you shared with me this morning. So what's this next piece of your journey going to entail?
I am going to Bright Divinity School. I have been accepted into their Master of Divinity program.
So she'll begin next fall.
Yes.
At seminary. Isn't that wonderful? You know, in this week's preaching resource from the Methodist Church, there was this quote, and that's talking about the disciples at Pentecost. Maybe it wasn't what they said. Maybe it wasn't the words they spoke, even if everyone could understand in his or her own language, that communicated the power of God's deeds to the crowd that was there to witness the incredible moment. Maybe it was who they were that most profoundly communicated God's deeds of power in a life-changing, transformational way to the onlookers. So who might like to respond to that quote? What does that evoke in you, or what do you think about that?
First thing I think of is the way that you live your life. I mean, that's your biggest testimony, is the way that people see you outside of Sunday. You know, the way that you show love to everyone that you see, not just a select few. Just showing that graciousness whenever it's not even asked for. That shows God's love in you. Because people will stop and say, why are you happy? Why are you smiling all the time? Why did you do that? And that opens the door for you to say, I didn't do it. God did it. Mm. You know, it was God in me that done it. I just did his will. And so that's what I see. That's how we show and can move all those barriers. Language is vast. You know, there's a whole thing to language. But you can, just by the way people can look at you and see you and watch you.
Great. Anybody else want to respond to that quote?
The images that came to my mind were the faces of so many people that we serve at AIDS Interfaith. And they come in from terrible circumstances, homeless, and things that are just enormous challenges. And yet, some of them show us love and gratitude. And they are so open and so... everything that you would not expect from people in that situation. Some of them come in and they give you that, and sometimes just by their presence and their demeanor, and just on maybe a slight word or a kindness they might show to each other. Sometimes it's like you can just see a spirit alive in them, and you wonder, how is that even possible given the circumstances that they're in? How would they even find that some kind of peace or ability to reach out to somebody else, because they're on the end of things, needing in great levels of need, and yet they're sometimes so willing to give something to somebody else, and inadvertently sometimes even to us who are there in the role to serve them, we end up being the ones who are served because of their kindness and grace.
So I hear you saying God can work in anyone.
Anyone.
And that's I think that's part of the miracle of Pentecost too, that we often overlook, because we assume that it was the 12 disciples or 11, you know, since Judas wasn't in there. Or had they replaced Judas yet? But that controversy aside, that we assume it was 11 that received the Holy Spirit, went out in the street, started speaking. But the text says everyone that was there. And when we look at some other texts, we see that there were women as well as men in that upper room. And everyone goes out in the street and is powerful. And Luke follows the story of Peter, and then later follows the story of Paul. So we tend to think that Peter's the only one speaking, but we know that it was all of them speaking. It says, how do we hear all of them in our own language? So I think we miss that powerful piece, that it wasn't just the preacher Peter that was talking. It was all of them, and that's surprising, because you had a tax collector, you had fishermen, you had educated and life experienced, shall I say. You had a real diversity of people, and diversity of ages as well. And I think that's one of those images for us to remember, that it was also who they were. Because that was part of the miracle, is seeing a fisherman delivering a powerful word and acting like a rabbi in that culture. That was shocking. I think we missed that. Well, I want to make sure that we take time here to ask each of you about what point of the Pentecost story or of your own experience of the Spirit do you want people to take away with them today? So what's important for you to share about the story itself or about your own life experience? Just what do you want people to take away? So I'm going to start with Kathy on this one.
It's hard to explain, but like Pastor Colleen was saying, everyone can understand it. Even if you can't figure out the words to say it, the Holy Spirit can help the other person or people take something away from it. It doesn't have to be a waste.
So everybody has something to say?
Yes.
Everybody has something to contribute. Okay. And say, Tyler, let's go to you.
I would hope that we all can recognize at least a little bit more how significant it is that the Holy Spirit lives inside of each of us, and that is what happened at Pentecost. I think of it as one of the truly distinctly beautiful qualities of Christianity. I know it was a wowing thing for me whenever I really dug into trying to understand Pentecost, but to know that they anticipated this day for thousands of years. They were waiting for, as the text you put up on the screen, that in the last days, the Holy Spirit was going to come, and that no longer would God just be here, but God would actually be dwelling on the inside. And what that means, that's what that means about human beings, what that means about you and I, and what life is going to be like and can be like, that God has taken up residence inside of humanity. Whenever I remember that, things feel somehow like a little bit better, or like there's more hope, or more joy, or more possibility, and more comfort and nearness. It's just like this has happened. It's actually happened. We're no longer waiting for the Holy Spirit to come. The Holy Spirit has come, and the Holy Spirit now is with us, and that's a permanent, irrevocable state. And that's just, that it encourages me in a very regular way, and I would hope that people would, when we think of Pentecost, it wouldn't just be like, oh, that weird event. It would be like, the time has happened, the time has come where God dwells with people again.
So these people don't have to wait on the Spirit coming.
Yeah, no.
Right? It's like Spirit's
very,
here.
Very here.
So then we go back to that accessing. We go back to that taking time to soak in the presence of God and be conscious of. Yeah. Carla.
Knowing and believing that everything you need is already within you. You don't have to go far to seek it. It's already there. God is equipped. The Holy Spirit, like you said, is already within you. You just have to take a moment and listen. You just have to take a moment, stop, connect. I think in our busy lives with all the electronics and all the easy access, we've lost the ability to just stop and connect nature, listen. He shows signs all over the place. You just have to be able to recognize them. They're there. The answers are right there. They're in you. They're around you. He's sending them through friends, family, anybody you have in contact with. So whatever you're going through, know that the answer is right there. You just have to stop and recognize it.
Kind of said, reminds me of be still and know.
Yes.
Be still and know. And Stephen.
Yeah. God gathers us, and from wherever we are. And it is the Spirit of God, I think, that connects us not only to ourselves and to God, but to each other. We build those bridges, I believe, through faith, and that we make room for each other and for ourselves through God's presence. And it's a gift that we don't have to ask for or don't have to experience in any specific way or any way that someone else experiences, but it's that presence is there, and we, as you have said, we have only to accept it and then act on that and let it be our point of connection in the world.
Accept that the Spirit is present. One of the things I was thinking about when I was preparing for this and looking at the kids is that awareness that the Spirit is as close as our breath and our breathing. And so we are always taking in God's presence, taking and exhaling our resistance, that the wind is always with us. There's never a time that the winds are still on the planet. It may be still here, but it's moving somewhere else. Amen? And so the Holy Spirit is always at work. And while they were anticipating this powerful experience of the Holy Spirit coming, the Spirit had always been present. The Spirit hovered over the waters in creation. The Spirit was present always. There is never a time the Spirit is not with you. That's one of the things I want you to be aware of. The Spirit is as close as your breath. Now, there's times when the wind is gentle and it's cooling and refreshing and, oh, yay. And then there's times that we have big storms, right? And the big storms usher in a big change. And sometimes we're terrified by them. I think of those disciples, like that was a huge change in their life. Suddenly they all had new careers. And the world looked at them completely differently. And yet God was with them. So sometimes big changes come, a tumultuous change, an upheaval. But I believe that God works through all things and works for good for all of us. It's not that God causes junk to happen to us, but we'll work in it, you know. It may be a little bit of a mixed metaphor here, but I'm going to go to the water. Shelley and I were driving in this morning. We were looking at all the fields that are covered like little lakes. And Bobby and I were at her doctor's this week, and they live out in one of those places where they have fields. Her doctor does, they've got a lot of acreage, and most of her acreage had been underwater. And the doctor was telling us that the kids have been going and rescuing fish from tire ruts and stuff, where when the waters receded, the fish that had washed up when the creek went over its banks were stuck in those ruts and stuff. And so she also said there was a smell because of the fish that were dying, that were stuck out in the fields. So we were talking about that this morning and thinking about how those fields are getting refertilized and how rich those fields are going to be later because of the nutrients that have come in from these waters. It's inconvenient, and yet there will be a good that will come out of it at the same time. So a mixed metaphor in looking at the water, but sometimes those tumultuous times will bring a good, a change, something that we couldn't have anticipated. In John's gospel, it said, when the advocate comes, who has come already now, whom I will send you from the heavenly parent, that's the source, the Spirit of truth who comes from God will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify. And last week we read that we were the witnesses. When Jesus ascended, Jesus said, you are my witnesses. And again, when we start talking about the Holy Spirit is with each of us, and we are witnesses. And each of you will speak in your own language with your own metaphors and your own images, and somebody else needs you to share your experience. Today, you probably related to one or more of these people, you know, more closely to one of their experiences. That's because God is speaking in the diversity of voices, and you need to add to that as well. You are witnesses to the presence of the Spirit at work in you, and in us and through us. Amen. Would you thank these people for sharing today?